Okay. All right. So we'll go ahead and get started. Hello and welcome to the virtual nursing grand rounds. My name is Diana Baptiste, and I'm a faculty member here at the School of Nursing. And so the Johns Hopkins School of Nursing holds this nursing grand rounds program on a monthly basis in partnership with the Nu Beta at-large chapter of Sigma. We offer monthly virtual nursing grand rounds continuing professional development series, providing an education program led by top researchers around the world. So just to let you know, for this virtual nursing grand rounds NCPD series, we will offer attendees one NCPD credit upon completion of each session with the goal of fulfilling the Johns Hopkins mission of providing lifelong learning in healthcare. With a mission of providing lifelong learning for healthcare professionals within our community. So as we begin, I'd like to introduce our speakers today. Our grand rounds for today we're going to be covering the history of nurse anesthesia, and it is my pleasure to welcome nurse anesthetists, four amazing nurse anesthetists within our Johns Hopkins community. Today we have Dr. Andy Benson, who is the Assistant Program Director of the DNP Nurse Anesthesia Track at the Johns Hopkins School of Nursing and former Chief CRNA at the Johns Hopkins Hospital. We also have with us today Dr. Catherine Horvath. She is an educator and administrator of the newly established DNP Nurse Anesthesia Program here at the School of Nursing. She's a certified nurse anesthetist. She has practiced in a variety of settings with differing surgical specialties and distinct care delivery models for nearly 30 years. And we also have Dr. Sarah Rollison here today. Dr. Sarah Rollison is a clinical education coordinator within the DNP Nurse Anesthesia Track at the Johns Hopkins School of Nursing. Dr. Rollison has extensive clinical expertise in anesthesia for neurosurgery, electrophysiology, gender-affirming surgery, and enhanced recovery after procedures. And then finally, we have Dr. Marjorie Everson. Dr. Marjorie Everson is a certified nurse anesthetist and is currently serving as an adjunct faculty for the DNP Nurse Anesthesia Track here at the School of Nursing. Dr. Everson is a member of the Board of Trustees at the American Association of Nurse Anesthesiology Foundation. She has previously served as an assistant professor and interim director of the Nurse Anesthesia Program at the University of Southern Mississippi. So without any further ado, I will hand it over to our speakers for today.
Great. Thank you, Dr. Baptiste, for that great introduction. And hello, everyone. Thank you for joining us today on behalf of the Nurse Anesthesia Program here at Hopkins. We're glad that you're here to hear a little bit about the history of nurse anesthesia. As Dr. Baptiste said, I'm Kathy Horvath, the program director, and I am joined by a team of faculty, Dr. Benson, Dr. Everson, and Dr. Rollison. So we do have some objectives today. We're going to spend a little time describing the evolution of nurse anesthesia practice here in the United States. We're going to introduce you to some names of some key pioneers in our history. And then we're going to talk about how nurse anesthesia education has evolved in our practice. So noted in the late 18th century, you know, people began to recognize that there were some substances that could be inhaled, like nitrous oxide and diether ether, that produced euphoria. So it has been recorded that there are some English scientists that experimented and even kind of partied with these substances in the late 18th century. It is reported that Crawford Long, a Georgian physician, used diethyl ether for removal of a small cyst, but unfortunately he did not record or report his findings. So there have been reports of two other men, Massachusetts physicians, Charles Jackson, and a dentist in Connecticut, who experimented with both nitrous oxide and ether. It was 4 years later, after Long's use of ether on October 16th, 1846, that a Boston area dentist named William Morton first used ether for surgical anesthesia. It was removal of a neck tumor on a gentleman in an operating room in a place now memorialized as the Ether Dome at Massachusetts General Hospital. So, but despite this demonstration and kind of the interest in the pharmacology of these drugs, in the 19th century, really physicians were concentrated on surgery, not on anesthesia as a medical specialty. The specialty was not thought to be economically attractive, and they felt like anesthesia as a specialty wasn't really worthy of a physician's intellect. So the work of anesthesia was relegated to others. So either students, newly graduated physicians, nurses, even custodians were giving anesthesia as surgery started to evolve. And kind of as a result of this medical disinterest and kind of, it evolving and with this overwhelming need for people to provide anesthesia, nurses were asked to give anesthesia for surgeries. So to back up a little bit, in the Civil War, which occurred in 1861 to 1865, this provided the first opportunities for nurses to really assume the duties of an anesthetist. Some of those experiences were recorded by a nurse named Catherine Lawrence. Catherine was a native of New York, and she wrote a 175-page autobiography in which she records giving anesthesia as a Union Army nurse. In her autobiography, she describes her duties of giving medications, suturing, and administering anesthesia for these poor soldiers that had injuries that needed surgical treatment on the field. And as a quote from her book, she says, "I rejoice that the time has arrived that our American nurses are being trained for positions that are so important. A skillful nurse is as important as a skillful physician." After the war, civilian nurses began practicing anesthesia, basically at the bequest of surgeons all over the country. And so this is a photo of Sister Mary Bernard, who actually founded the Sisters of St. Joseph of Wichita, Kansas. And in 1977, she entered St. Vincent's Hospital, actually in Erie, Pennsylvania, to train as a nurse. And a year later, at that same hospital in Erie, Pennsylvania, she took over all the anesthesia duties for the hospital. And so, she, very prominent person in the hospital, had a lot of duties. And this kind of continued over and over. There was another group of nuns, the Franciscan Sisters, who were very active in building and staffing St. John's Hospital in Springfield, Illinois. And they were particularly successful in preparing sisters as nurses and as nurse anesthetists to go out to other Midwestern hospitals in the area. Now, Alice McGaw was born in Ohio, and her family later relocated to Rochester, Minnesota. And Alice decided she wanted to become a nurse. So she went to Chicago, Illinois, and attended the Women's Hospital School of Nursing in Chicago because she wanted to go back and be near her family. She returned to Rochester and she became a nurse anesthetist for Dr. William and Dr. Charles Mayo at St. Mary's Hospital, which then became the Mayo Clinic. McGaw, along with one of her pupils that she was teaching in the hospital named Florence Henderson, she refined and kind of advocated for the dripping of ether and developed an open drop method of giving anesthesia. And this type of anesthesia required a huge amount of vigilance and careful attention to detail. And I'll show you a picture of it on the next slide and kind of describe it. McGaw and her pupil Henderson went on to kind of improve the safety of anesthesia care. In 1899, she became the first nurse anesthetist to publish when she published in the Northwest Lancet, when they printed an article called The Observations of Anesthesia. She went on to have five publications, the last of which was a review of over 14,000 surgical anesthesias that she gave. And this was published in the Journal of Surgery, Gynecology and Obstetrics. In her writing, she documented again, these 14,000 anesthetics, and she said they were without incidents, the need for artificial respirations, or the occurrence of a pneumonia or any serious results, which is fantastic for patient safety at that time period. So this is just a photo of what it looks like to give an open drop ether technique. Basically, they used a metal cage and put a piece of cloth in the cage, and then they would drip the anesthetic on the cloth and then place it on the patient's face. And you can imagine as you place this piece of cloth over the face, you're one, trapping in CO2, which can cause problems, and you can lack oxygen delivery because you're placing kind of something closed over the face. And as they breathe this anesthetic, the anesthetic would cause the respirations to slow down, and then more of these vapors would get trapped under that cloth, that cloth apparatus, and then they would take larger and larger concentrations of the gas as they were drifting off to sleep. So again, it took a lot of vigilance and care providing this kind of anesthetic. And as this technique became more safe and standardized, Charles Mayo bestowed upon her the name of the mother of anesthesia for her mastery of this technique. So there was kind of a second mecca of nurse anesthesia that was developing at the same time in Cleveland, Ohio. In the 1900s, Agatha Hodgkins, who was a Canadian nurse, she went to Cleveland to work at Lakeside Hospital. And it was there she worked with a surgeon called Dr. George Kreil. And he asked her to become her nurse anesthetist, his personal nurse anesthetist in 1908, which was, common of those times to kind of have your a person that you worked with all the time. And together with Dr. Kreil, Hodgkins pioneered the use of nitrous and oxygen anesthesia. Hodgkins' primary interest, though, was in education. She taught anesthesia to many, many nurses, physicians, and even a few lay persons over the years. Because Lakeside Hospital was the recipient of many requests for surgical training, so they had lots of surgeons come to the facility to learn surgical techniques, they would customarily bring along a nurse to learn about anesthesia. At Lakeside Hospital, they had developed a gas machine that was introduced in 1910 called the Ohio monovalve gas machine. And that's what helped them perfect this nitrous oxide oxygen technique. So again, these nurses would come along with the surgeons and learn the technique. Over time, there were so many surgeons and so many kind of nurses coming through. Agatha felt like they needed to kind of stabilize the workforce and the work necessary to do this kind of work. So she started thinking about kind of postgraduate schools. So these nurses would come, but what would a postgraduate nursing program look like for anesthesia? So in 1915, Agatha Hopkins opened a school at Lakeside Hospital. The Lakeside School was not the first formal postgraduate anesthesia program that developed, and Dr. Everson will talk about that in a minute. But the Lakeside School is the only one that kind of has original documents that still exist from its opening. The admission requirements were, admission requirements, and then the students took courses, both clinical and didactic components, and the programs lasted about 6 months long. There was tuition that was charged, and at about the time, it was about $100, which I'm sure all of the students in our program right now would like to go back to those times. And then a diploma was granted at the end of the program. And so again, she was very much a pioneer of nursing education. Agatha also was the chief nurse anesthetist chief anesthetist of the whole department of anesthesia at Lakeside Hospital. The Lakeside Hospital School did promote the establishment of many, many other programs across the United States. Another honor that goes to Agatha Hopkins is that in 1931, she alone founded the American Association of Nurse Anesthetists, which was the first professional organization of anesthesia of its kind. I do also have to mention that nurse anesthetists played a very large role in World War I. Their involvement actually began before 4 years before the United States became militarily involved. Nurse anesthetists went over to kind of help with some of the effort, and that lasted until the end of the war. A number of these nurses, the number of nurses that actually practiced anesthesia during the war is unknown, but there is documentation that they are credited for, again, bringing over that nitrous oxide oxygen technique and teaching it to the French and the English troops there. And as kind of a result of this superior nursing practice, both the Army and the Navy at that time started sending their nurses for anesthesia training for the first time. And, our military colleagues are very strong in nurse anesthesia education to this day. I'm now going to turn it over to Dr. Marjorie Everson, who's going to talk a little bit more about the roots of education for our nurse anesthesia practice.
Thank you, Dr. Horvath. So as we move into the nurse anesthesiology education, it's worth noting another pioneer of our profession, Helen Lamb. She was one of five original trustees in the National Association of Nurse Anesthetists, which was the precursor of the American Association of Nurse Anesthetists. So she trained at the famous Lakeside Hospital School of Anesthesia in Cleveland in the 1920s, and she remained there until she was recruited by Dr. Graham at Barnes Hospital in St. Louis. And she became his personal anesthetist for over 20 years, and she actually performed anesthesia for the very first pneumonectomy. And she became the director of the Barnes Hospital School of Anesthesia in 1929, which is now the Washington University School of Nurse Anesthesia. And she was the director until she retired in 1951. She was also elected as the fifth president of our association. And today our association gives a national award in her name. It's the Helen Lamb Outstanding Educator Award. And it's presented to a CRNA who's made significant contributions in education, in the education of nurse anesthetists. So next. So our early education at the turn of the 20th century, there were three modalities for training anesthesia providers. There were visiting nurses and physicians that Dr. Horvath mentioned. They would go and observe anesthesia, and sometimes they actually got to administer some of it under the supervision. And then manufacturers the manufacturers or demonstrators of the anesthesia equipment traveled around the country and taught people how to use the equipment. And then of course the hospitals employed trained their own nurse anesthetists. So here's a little bit of a timeline. So here's our early beginnings. In 1909, Agnes McGee founded the very first educational program in St. Vincent's Hospital in Portland, Oregon. And then between 1912 and 1922, more than 19 more nurse-led anesthesia schools were opened in major cities, including Johns Hopkins Hospital in 1917 and my own alma mater, Charity Hospital in New Orleans in 1917. So these programs set a trend to prepare our graduate nurses as anesthetists instead of trying to prepare them within the basic nursing education programs. In 1927, Ralph Waters created the first American Medical Academic Anesthesia Department and residency for programs. So you see, they were a little bit behind us, and this started in Madison, Wisconsin. In the 1930s, the AANA discussed setting educational standards and the credentialing process for nurse anesthesia education. And they also discussed licensure, registration, or certification of nurse anesthetists. In 1934, the AANA actually set a curriculum for nurse anesthesia educational programs. And they considered the program's success, it was based on the knowledge and skills of its graduates. And then finally, in 1935, minimum standards for anesthesia school curricula were established. So early, these are the early minimal standards, length 6 months, but preferably a year, 95 hours of classroom instruction, and at least 18 hours of operating room instruction in the class. And so they had to administer 325 anesthetics. 250 of them were general, 25 OB, 25 dental, and 25 regional. So next we have, this is really pretty cool. This is a recruitment brochure that disseminated to schools of nursing to counteract the negative effects of anti-nurse anesthetist public relations. So, you know, during and after World War II, the American Society of Anesthesiologists, they published articles in women's magazines to discredit nurse anesthetists. So, you know, our battle started a long time ago. They also mandated that their members were not allowed to educate nurse anesthetists, but many physician anesthesiologists ignored this mandate, including at Charity Hospital, which our original nurse anesthesia program was run by a physician. So a lot of them just ignored that. So now we're moving on to our timeline. In 1937, the American Board of Anesthesiology was formed, and it was under the auspices of the American Board of Surgery. And that was for the purpose of devising a plan for certifying physicians in the field of anesthesiology. But the American Board of Surgery felt that having one board to attend to matters of both the physicians and physician certification and nurse certification might be fruitful instead of having you know, an American Board of Anesthesiology and then the Nurse Anesthesia Association. So they talk to their anesthesiologists under their, in their ranks and said, hey, you know, we're going to open our ranks to the nurses and they can become board certified under, you know, the American Board of Surgery. And then the anesthesiologists were not, they were already weren't too happy being under the Board of Surgery. And then even made them more angry that they were pressuring them to embrace accepting nurse anesthetists into their fold. So kind of put them into an unhappy relationship. And it was pointed out that no other specialty board was acting as a supervisor of training for a technician group, that they called the nurses the technician group, and that they shouldn't have to be involved in our education. So this is, you know, so in 1945, the AANA gave its first national certification. In 1952, the AANA established an accreditation program for nursing anesthesia education, which is now called the Council on Accreditation of Nursing Anesthesia Educational Programs, the COA. And in 1972, the AANA mandated that each anesthesia education program had to be at least 2 years and had to have greater curricular requirements added to the original education programs, both in didactic and clinical components. And then the minimal didactic requirements included an equivalency of about 2 semester course of anatomy and physiology and pathophysiology, 2 semester courses of advanced pharmacology, 2 to 3 semester courses of principles of anesthesia practice, 1 course of chemistry and physics, and 1 semester course of professional aspects. Also, your clinical correlative conferences were also required. So many of us in school had, we had grand rounds. So we had to go at least once a month and for a couple of hours, and that was all part of our training. So here's the rest of the story. The anesthesiologists tried to take control of our education and create their own education accrediting body and certification body. In 1975, the COA, the Council on Accreditation of Educational Programs, was established as a separate and autonomous council from the AANA based on the U.S. Office of Education, because you know, the anesthesiologist said, well, your professional organization cannot be an accreditor and a certifier of the profession because that's a conflict of interest. So, and, you know, and it was a conflict of, and it was going against what the U.S. Office of Education had as standard. So in 1975, there were separate councils, the Council on Accreditation and then our certification body at, during that time. So in 1983, an alarming number, we don't know what happened, but a lot of programs closed in 1983, and especially those in academic health centers, including Johns Hopkins, which had been in existence for more than 60 years. The reason cited most frequently was there were an increasing number of medical school graduates seeking to enter into anesthesiology residencies. The clinical resources were needed for them. And some anesthesiologists were willing to admit off the record that it was because they did not want to participate in preparing their competitors and therefore were closing or reducing the clinical access to nurse anesthesia students. So as of 2021, there were 124 accredited CRNA programs in the United States and Puerto Rico, and we graduate about 2,400 graduates a year. So we're doing our part trying to close the gap. Our education went from being a certificate program all the way to being a doctoral entry program. And we were the first advanced practice nursing specialty to adopt the entry into practice doctoral degree. Now, although we've had some struggles through the years, nursing anesthesia educational programs are flourishing. So now we're going to discuss the history of nursing anesthesiology at Johns Hopkins.
Great. Well, thank you, Dr. Everson. And I'm excited to tell you guys about the history of nurse anesthesia at Johns Hopkins because it's quite extraordinary. So we'll start with Isabel Hampton Robb. She was a leading pioneer in nursing. And as we know, she was the first superintendent of the Johns Hopkins School of Nursing, which had opened up in 1889. So in 1893, she published a nursing textbook that was titled Nursing, Its Principles and Practices for Hospital and Private Use. Well, in this textbook included a chapter titled The Administration of Anesthetics. So she was definitely well aware of anesthesia. In 1906, at American Hospital Association Convention, Henry Heard, which we know he was a superintendent of JHH, stated that the instruction of physicians in anesthesia was fragmented, unsystematic, and haphazard. So anesthesia training at the time was very much empirical instruction in the operating room and not a formal process. So most nurses, as we know, were either personally trained by surgeons for whom they worked or by other nurses in the hospital. In 1908, Dr. Heard stated that in training school for anesthesia providers, an effort should be made to give nurses who intend to go into surgical practice much more careful instruction in the use of these anesthetics. 9 years later, in 1917, as a result of the superior quality of anesthesia performed by the nurse anesthetist, they were given the responsibility for surgical anesthesia at Johns Hopkins. So that was kind of the start there. Next slide, good. The Johns Hopkins Hospital School for Anesthesia for Nurses was a training program for registered nurses that existed as early as 1917 until about 1985 when it was closed. The program was a separate school within the Johns Hopkins Hospital and was later administered by the Department of Anesthesiology after its founding as a division in 1952 and then as a separate hospital department in 1975. So under the direction of Margaret Boyce, her primary focus of this early anesthesia program was delivering anesthesia care, which was then kind of supplemented by classroom instruction, clinics, and physician-led lectures. The students administered anesthesia for 400 cases throughout the course of her training. And upon earning their certificate, they were required to work at Hopkins for 2 years. And then the nurse anesthetists were assigned and dedicated to one surgical team. Next slide. So Margaret Boyce was trained at the Mayo Clinic by Florence Henderson. We learned about her earlier in this lecture. She had arrived in 1913 from New York. She was initially employed by Dr. Crowell. He was an otolaryngologist as his private anesthetist. Then Hopkins surgeon William Halstead, who was renowned for introducing rubber gloves in the operating room, using cocaine as a surgical anesthetic, as well as for his own personal use. And he developed the radical mastectomy for breast cancer. His surgical expertise, though, became thyroid cases. He also had this model of, his model of teaching formed the basis of modern surgical residency training. So a lot of history there. But initially, Dr. Halstead resisted nurse anesthetists. He didn't want anything to do with them. However, he could not help but observe how the problems of anesthesia were being handled with the services of Dr. Crowe and Young. And he quickly noticed that Miss Boyce's skill with ether administration was impressive. So when Margaret Boyce had been at Hopkins for a few months, he asked to borrow her for the administration of anesthesia for a difficult thyroid operation. Well, after that, it seemed to take very little convincing to acknowledge the skill of nurse anesthetists. And Miss Boyce was soon employed by the Johns Hopkins Hospital as the head anesthetist for the surgical department. And she gave the anesthetics to most of all Dr. Halstead's patients until his death in 1922. Next slide, thank you. So in 1921, an RN from Montclair, New Jersey, who graduated from the School of Nursing at Roosevelt Hospital in New York, had arrived to Baltimore. Admitted into the nurse anesthesia program, this student was beginning her journey, which would influence and shape the future of nurse anesthesia education, contribute to clinical scholarship, and make a critical impact on the nurse anesthesia profession. And this nurse was one we all have become familiar with, Miss Olive Berger. So Miss Berger graduated from the program in 1922, and she initially started with the gynecology surgical service when she finished her program. She then left Hopkins in 1929 to work at a children's hospital in Chattanooga, Tennessee, only to return to Baltimore in 1931 as the chief nurse anesthetist and then the director of the anesthesia school for nurses. In this picture, you can see the class of 1922 graduates. Right in the center is Margaret Boyce. And then on the far right, you'll notice is Olive Berger. I love this photo. So in 1944, Johns Hopkins surgeons Dr. Alfred Blaylock and Dr. Helen Tossig completed their first repair of tautology of Fallot syndrome. This was experimental surgery on these babies with a congenital heart defect who were blue in color and had dark purple lips. Olive Berger didn't get credit for delivering the anesthetic on the first case, but she was there observing and taking notes. In fact, in the Johns Hopkins archives, they have her logbook titled Tautologies, which kind of describes the first 100 cases and details of patient medical history, complications, and outcomes. By the way, 23 of the first 100 patients had died from this procedure. So it's exemplary that Ms. Berger was able to master the art and the science of clinical anesthesia to care for these complex patient population without all of today's technology and pharmacology. So if you just think about it, the nurse anesthetists were palpating pulse for the strength for blood pressure. They were assessing skin and blood color for oxygenation. And they were using handbag mask ventilation before the invention of ventilators. The anesthesia consisted of a delicate combination of cyclopropane, ether, and oxygen. Also, the standard of practice was not routinely to use endotracheal tubes on these pediatric cases, as there was limited equipment for the pediatrics and modifications had to be made. So Olive used newly developed uncocked endotracheal tubes with a preference to, quote, this is in one of her writings, to assist respirations by gentle rhythmic compression of the breathing bag to minimize movements of the mediastinum. And she did this for the 4.5 hour procedure. I just find that extraordinary. She also documented in other cases that many patients are sufficiently conscious to answer questions or respond to simple directions before leaving the operating room. And this was absolutely necessary because there is no such thing as a recovery room.
So the stuff from day 28,
next slide.
But I can't. Oh, wait. No, but
so here's a picture of the first closed circuit televised baby surgery at JHH. Now, the lady at the head of the bed is unidentified, but I'm pretty sure we can assume that this is probably Olive Berger. Next slide. Good. So remarkably, out of the 475 blue baby anesthetics that she recorded, Olive Berger delivered 289 or 61% of the anesthetics, while 41 cases were completed by physician anesthetists, and the remainder of the cases were performed between 5 other nurse anesthetists. Next slide. As innovative early nurse anesthetist Olive Berger, and when here's Helen Lamb, again, enters the picture. She was, as we know, she was a nurse at Barnes Hospital in St. Louis. They developed an endotracheal technique for intrathoracic surgery. Building on this technical acumen, Olive made clinical history, which she administered anesthesia for the very first pneumonectomy at JHH. So Olive was a leader in research and academic scholarship, and she focused on ensuring high quality and safe anesthesia. Berger published her anesthetic technique and outcomes in 2 detailed articles, which were required reading for the nascent specialty. At an American Association of Nurse Anesthetists meeting in September in 1948, Berger's 45-minute presentation, a detailed question and answer session, followed Dr. Blaylock's presentation entitled Cardiac Surgery with Particular Reference to the Treatment of Pulmonic Stenosis. So these combined addresses kind of demonstrated her collaborative willingness to share her skill and her knowledge. Olive was an extraordinary leader for the nurse anesthesia profession. In the mid-1940s, there was a call from the AANA to form state organizations. Olive Berger was instrumental in creating the Maryland Association of Nurse Anesthetists. And when MANA was formed in 1946, Olive was elected vice president. She then served as the second MANA president from 1947 to 1949. She then was elected to the ANA Board of Trustees in 1952, and she quickly made her way up the ranks of ANA leadership. And in 1958, she became the 14th president of the AANA. Olive was on the forefront of setting standards for anesthesia training. Pioneer educational ventures started a shift of emphasis from service to education. At the second ANA meeting in Philadelphia in September of 1934, Miss Berger served on the inaugural education committee with Helen Lamb and Agatha Hodgins. This was the meeting where that the Foundation for Educational Standards, Curriculum, and a national examination were discussed, leading to conversations about anesthesia school accreditation. For the Johns Hopkins Nurse Anesthesia Program, Ms. Berger advocated for 4 hours per week of didactic education, consisting of anatomy and physiology, anesthesia pharmacology, history of anesthesia, and anesthesia equipment, all very similar from today's curriculum. Exceeding the national standard, she expected 500 hours of practical time and 600 hours of anesthesia within the year of training of the training program. So based on her program, other early nurse anesthetist leaders developed a similar curricular standards for nurse anesthesia education throughout the nation. At Hopkins, she trained at least 4 anesthesia students per year. And 2 of the program's graduates during Ms. Berger's direction went on and became ANA presidents. So during Olive Berger's career, she successfully navigated an environment that constantly contested the scope of practice for nurse anesthetists and the battling between the medical and the nursing anesthesia practice. She worked diligently to establish and maintain autonomy for the nurse anesthesia profession. It is clear from the archive notes that Olive Berger and Dr. Blaylock worked very closely together and really developed and formed a strong team. This relationship had great influence on Dr. Blaylock's decision to continue advocating for and working with nurse anesthetists. At the time, Dr. Austin Lamont, he was the Johns Hopkins Director of Anesthesia, had submitted a proposal to create a new physician specialty in anesthesiology, where the future of anesthesia would be determined by physician anesthesiologists. Well, Dr. Blaylock rejected this, and he didn't see any need to change his routine and believed that nurse anesthetists were sufficient for the job. With rejection of this proposal, Dr. Lamont resigned and he left Hopkins with disappointment. In an interview, Olive explains, quote, "Lots of places had nurse anesthetists, but also had physician anesthetists in charge, but we didn't." She goes on to say that Dr. Blaylock did not want it and Dr. Blaylock had great faith in us. Next slide. So Olive became the chief CRNA in 1931. And really from that time, she managed the anesthesia department, administered anesthesia in countless operations, and remained head of the department until her retirement in 1969. Olive coordinated the ORs and worked very closely with Dr. Blaylock. She was in charge of everything until Dr. Benson came as an anesthesia director. One of my CRNA colleagues, who's now retired, shared a story with me about Olive. And she said that Olive was hard of hearing and wore these two hearing aids that were then attached to a box and hooked into her scrubs. So coordinating these ORs when surgeons or other doctors would be upset with her, she would simply just turn off her hearing aid device and ignore them. So I think she was a force to be reckoned with. So during her years at Hopkins, she lived at the Hampton House, which was right across the street as a residence across the street that housed nursing faculty and all the nursing students. In 1952, she was recognized as an instructor of anesthesia in the School of Medicine. And then prior to her retirement, a portrait of Olive, as seen here, was commissioned. Financial contributions from her colleagues surpassed the cost by almost three times. This portrait now hangs outside the chief CRNA office in the Blaylock building, which is interesting. So the Agatha Hodgins Award was established by the ANA in 1975 for outstanding accomplishments. Befitting her legacy, Olive was honored in 1980 with the Agatha Hodgins Award, recognizing her dedication to excellence and furthering the art and science of nurse anesthesia. Olive was too frail to attend the meeting that year. However, she was recognized by her peers and her colleagues, and even President Carter from the White House. In 2018, as the chief CRNA, I created an annual CRNA award in her honor, which is given in January during the CRNA week, to recognize a CRNA who excels in leadership and clinical practice. It is truly a tribute to Olive Berger's amazing career, leadership, and clinical skills. This week, the latest CRNA will be announced and be recognized for their achievements. And so Lady Olive, as they called her at Hopkins, was on the forefront of our minds when we reestablished and launched the nurse anesthesia program at the School of Nursing in 2020. I think that she would be most proud of her efforts and really excited to see Johns Hopkins once again educating future CRNAs. So I'm gonna turn it over to Dr. Rollison to share with us about nurse anesthesia scope of practice.
Thank you, Dr. Benson. Thank you everybody for being here today. I'm going to move us a little bit more into the current state of CRNA practice. We've had a very good discussion about the rich history, which has led us to where we are today. CRNAs, of course, are advanced practice registered nurses. We plan and deliver anesthesia care, as well as pain management and all related care. Every year we deliver about more than 50 million anesthetics, and we are autonomous providers. We can be the sole provider for a patient or an institution. The ability for our CRNAs to practice to our full autonomous scope is determined by state statutes and regulations, as well as institutional policies. And we'll talk a little bit more about this later. CRNAs can care for patients in all settings, including hospitals, ambulatory surgery centers, non-operating room anesthesia, or office-based settings. We care for patients in all specialties, including but not limited to general surgery, obstetrics, trauma, cardiac surgery, orthopedics, gastrointestinal, pediatrics, dental procedures, plastic surgery, and so many more. And we can practice in all locations, urban, rural, military, and in underserved populations. Next slide, please. So really, you know, from all of my friends and family who are non-healthcare, as well as maybe some people who are in the healthcare field, always ask, what do you do exactly? So this here is the answer. This is a graphical representation of the full scope of practice of nurse anesthetists, and it is a bit of a busy slide, so I'll break it down. So our scope of practice allows us to autonomously complete all necessary portions of operative care, including the pre-procedural assessment and evaluation, implementing a patient-specific anesthetic plan, and recovering that patient from the anesthetic care. Regarding our clinical skills, we're trained and able to place basic and advanced airways, invasive lines such as arterial and central lines. We manage epidurals, spinals, regional peripheral blocks, continuous nerve block catheters, and we can even place them as well. Frequently, we're considered airway experts, and we're trained in all areas of anesthesia management. Our educational training covers pathophysiology, physiology, pharmacology, health assessment, principles of anesthesia, and so much more, and we're clinically trained in all surgical specialties. We provide care through each area of the operative phase, but we're not solely limited to operating room anesthesia. We can work in pain management and multimodal pain services, and we're also seen in different roles, such as on airway teams throughout the hospitals. Next slide, please. All right. So our CRNA practice and supervision is really what determines our scope of practice ability. We are always trained to our full scope, but what determines how well we can practice to our autonomous level is determined by regulations. In November of 2001, the Centers for Medicare and Medicaid Services published a final rule concerning the federal Medicare and Medicaid physician supervision requirement for CRNAs. This rule amended the requirement in many different conditions. So anesthesia services condition for participation for hospitals, for ambulatory surgery centers, and as well as for critical access hospitals. This rule determines that for Medicare reimbursement, CRNAs need to be supervised by physicians, surgeons, or anesthesiologists. States can opt out of this requirement, and to date, 19 states have. In order to do so, they have to have their state governor send a letter of attestation to the CMS. They have to attest that the governor's consulted with the state boards of medicine and nursing about issues for access to care. They have to say that it's in the best interest of the state citizens to opt out, and they have to say that it's consistent with state law. Now, in March of 2020, CMS suspended the supervision requirement for CRNAs in order to increase the capacity of U.S. healthcare delivery during the COVID-19 pandemic. Several governors also removed many barriers to CRNA practice during this crisis. According to a January 2021 CMS report, CRNAs were among the top 20 specialties that served the most beneficiaries in non-telehealth care between March and June of 2020, the height of the pandemic. Next slide, please. You'll see here this map shows the current 19 states that have opted out of the CMS regulation for supervision. States that have opted out are in green, states that have not are in red. Colorado is blue. They've opted out of CMS regulation for supervision, but specifically for critical access hospitals and rural hospitals only. Next slide. And so we've talked a bit about reimbursement, but what about safety? CRNAs are proven time and time again to be just as safe as if we were working alone or with a physician. In fact, the Institute of Medicine and the American Association of Nurse Anesthesiologists, as well as the American Society of Anesthesiologists, concur that anesthesia itself is about 50 times safer today than it was back in the 80s. So I hope that brings some comfort to some of our participants today. But this landmark study here, No Harm Found When Nurse Anesthetists Work Without Supervision by Physicians, performed an analysis of Medicare data from 1999 to 2005. After that CMS supervision requirement was put in place in 2001, 14 states had executed the right to opt out by 2005. Analysis of the data showed no evidence that opting out of the oversight requirement resulted in any sort of increase in patient death or complications. This study actually recommended that the CMS allow CRNAs to work in every state without the supervision of a surgeon or anesthesiologist. Since this study, there have been many more that reflect the safety when practicing independently compared to other models of anesthesia delivery. Next slide. Another landmark study showed the cost efficacy of CRNAs. We provide safe quality care that is cost effective to many people. This study showed that the CRNA working as the sole anesthesia provider is 25% more cost effective than the next most cost effective model of anesthesia care delivery. And why is that? We'll see on the next slide. Regardless of the type of anesthesia provider, CRNA or physician, Medicare will reimburse the same amount for that anesthesia care. Moving on, anesthesiologist physicians have a salary that averages that about 2.5 times of CRNAs. Where does this compensation get covered? That higher compensation for the anesthesiologist care is now the responsibility of the facility, or if the facility does not absorb it, of the patient. Next slide, please. So our CRNAs allow that cost-effective access to safe anesthesia care for those underserved populations. In fact, CRNAs represent more than 80% of the anesthesia providers in rural counties, and many critical access hospitals rely on independently practicing CRNAs for care. So overall, we've proven that we're safe, we're cost-effective, and we really enjoy our jobs. And this week, we're all celebrating our CRNAs as it is National CRNA Week. We celebrate our history, our profession, where we have come and where we go, and we are excited and grateful that you're here to celebrate with us. And I believe that wraps up our conversation today. We'll open the floor for any conversation or discussions.
Thank you. Thank you to all of our speakers for today to helping us learn the amazing history and evolution of the CRNA role throughout time. So yes, we will open the floor for questions now. Feel free to paste your questions into the chat, or you can raise your hand and we'll be happy to and ask you to unmute yourselves and ask your question verbally. Any questions right now for Drs. Benson, Everson, Drs. Horvath, and Dr. Rollison?
I have a question, and this might have been touched on during the presentation, but I noticed that like back when the School of Nursing was under the hospital, it did have a nurse anesthesia program. And I was wondering how that program differs from the current DNP anesthesia track.
So this is Kathy Horvath. So that program was very much a hospital-based training program. It, I'm sure, evolved as our educational requirements increased over time, but it was still very much a hospital-based program. Currently, all programs are at the doctoral level, so they are university-based programs that are run by academic institutions that then partner with clinical institutions to get their the clinical education part of the program. But there's much more foundational learning that needs to occur on the university level, along with the clinical education.
Thank you, Dr. Horvath. And we do have a question in the chat from Wilson Will. He says, is there any drive to increase CRNA practice autonomy here in Maryland?
I'll answer that one. This is Sarah Rollison. Yes, there is absolutely always a drive to increase our autonomous practice. I will say that throughout the state of Maryland, institutional guidelines make it differ very greatly as far as what we do in practice. So across the street at Johns Hopkins Hospital, we are in an anesthesia care team model. There are a few facilities throughout Maryland where CRNAs have much greater autonomous practice. But from the state and regulatory level, there is currently actually a bill going through right now for CRNA prescriptive authority, which is not something that we've had in the past. So there's constantly advocacy from our Maryland Association of Nurse Anesthetists to work with our local legislators to increase our autonomy from the federal level. So it's a pretty exciting time to be a CRNA.
Great, thanks for sharing that, Dr. Rollison. Just going to the chat, looking at Tina Bergstrom says, I work at Massachusetts General and we have a photo depicting the first procedure using, procedure using anesthetic from the ether dome hanging in the staff lounge. So interesting to hear more of about the story behind it. So thank you, Tina, for that comment. And we do have a question from Pandora. Pandora says, can you please tell us a bit about what is happening in the global arena for nurse anesthesia?
So right now we have an International Federation of Nurse Anesthesia. Anesthesia is not as developed like nurse anesthesia in a lot of countries. So what the International Federation is doing is trying to bring together those who are in the, you know, smaller countries, and they're trying to establish guidelines for their education and trying to get them certified and getting them, you know, to be more respected and more known. And Kathy, do you have anything to add to that?
The only thing I would say, there it definitely is a global surgery initiative globally, and anesthesia is part of that. Dr. Everson is correct in talking about this Federation of Nursing, International Federation of Nurse Nurses. They are definitely trying to kind of raise the bar globally for nurse anesthesia scope of practice. But it gets back to kind of those educational beginnings. I think a lot of countries are still struggling with more one-on-one training or, you know, again, back to that custodial, I talked about our beginnings, you know, some of the nurse anesthetists even train, you know, they train the custodians in the institutions to give anesthesia because they just felt like, okay, I'll teach how to do this task, but I'm going to be doing the surgery. Well, I think some countries are still operating that way. And so this federation is really, and many other federations are helping to kind of push the safety of surgery in other countries. And anesthesia is a big part of that. So they're trying to make anesthesia more safe by increasing the education requirements in those countries.
Great. Thank you, Dr. Horvath. So looking in the chat, Julie Block wrote House Bill number 55. So I'm thinking that might have something to do with the discussion about autonomy of practice in the state of Maryland. So would you like to comment on that?
I believe the bill that I was referring to about the prescriptive authority. So it's going around right now, circulating in our CRNA and SRNA little conversations to sign to support the bill and the prescriptive authority in Maryland, since we don't currently have that as CRNAs here. So that's excellent. Yes, Julie's one of ours. So I think she gets an A and passes for knowing that, right?
Right. And remembering the number, that's not always easy. Well, thank you for speaking on that. So please, to the audience, feel free to unmute yourself if you have a question or add something in the chat. We will wrap up within a couple of minutes. So we would love to just hear from you before we conclude this session. Okay. Well, some more chats. Great. All right. So Michelle Patch has a question. She says, how many states currently allow prescriptive authority for CRNAs? And I'm not sure if you've answered this already, Dr. Rollison.
I believe I've answered it, but I also don't believe I know the number off the top of my head. I'll ask if one of the other panelists know. It's very specific to each state. So I will see if they happen to know.
I am afraid I don't know the answer to that either. You know, our prescriptive authority in the intraoperative arena is covered with our certification and our licensing as an advanced provider within at the state level. However, many CRNAs seek additional, you know, prescriptive authority because they do want to work in outside of that arena, like in pain clinics and things like that. So I'm afraid I don't know an exact statistic.
And I'll add to that just to clarify, you know, we do have, as Dr. Horvath said, authority within the perioperative scope to say, I want to give this medication preoperatively, these medications intraoperatively, and this postoperatively. But more what the prescriptive authority bill that's currently in place is talking about is that outside of the OR, outside of the operating room, prescriptive authority in an outpatient setting. So I hope that clarifies.
Thank you. Thank you both. So Pandora Hartman in the chat wants to thank you. And she wants us to know that she's part of the Safe Surgery Initiative going on globally. And she would love to connect and to learn more, to speak more about the opportunity to collaborate with the School of Nursing. So she has pasted her email address into the chat. So we will be sure to share that with our panelists moving forward. Thank you, Pandora. We always appreciate new collaborations here. And that is like one of the purposes of the Virtual Nursing Grand Rounds is not only to learn about the advancements that are happening in nursing, but also to connect with those who are really involved and those making those advancements. So just a couple of another chat question here from Melissa Paradise, and I hope I said your name correctly. Excuse me if I didn't. So Melissa asks a question. She says, what qualities stand out for a CRNA candidate looking to apply to the Johns Hopkins DNP program?
Does anybody want to take this one, or are we okay if I start? We look for a lot of different things. Most importantly, we look for the requirements that are in place for applying to any program, ICU level of experience, and the type of experience you got in the ICU. But really, when we meet with people, we look for students that are engaged, willing to learn, receptive to feedback, and who are very self-aware, who can say things like, you know, I've tried this and I realized it didn't work for me, so here's what I moved on to, or here's what I did differently. But we're looking for people who are excited and about the profession, who want to be a strong CRNA, and who are willing to give a good portion of their adult life to being an educated, well-respected advanced practice nurse. And I'll let the other panelists chime in as well.
Sure, I'll just add that, we want to select people who are like passionate about it and have like shadowed in the OR and love it, because it's a rigorous program. And so you really have to love it. You've got to be excited about it, and you have to be able to, make it through all of those hard didactic courses and stuff. But, you know, we strongly encourage that you shadow and really see if that's what you want to do with your career.
Yeah, and we also like for students to take, our applicants to take care of the hardest patients and question, why am I doing this? Not just, I'm getting an order, have to do this, blah. We want you to know why, because you're going to apply that. You know, you're not going to have somebody giving you orders in the operating room. You're going to have to figure out, I've got to give this drug and this is what's going to happen and this patient, you know. So we like people who are taking care of the high acuity patients, understand why, question why, not be disrespectful, but question why am I doing this, and what are the outcome going to be. So those are some of the qualities we look at too.
Well, thank you. So at this moment, we are going to go ahead and conclude the session, and I want to thank Drs. Horvath, Dr. Benson, Dr. Rollison, and Dr. Everson for joining us today and helping us understand the role of the CRNA within the profession of advanced practice nursing. Also help us understand the history and evolution to see where this amazing profession has begun and where it is today, and how we're going to continue advancing it as a community. So I want to really thank you all for being here with us, sharing your knowledge and sharing your expertise. And we wish you all the best and have a wonderful day. Just a reminder, for those who have registered and attended, you will receive a link to complete an evaluation, and that's where you will get your NPCD credit for this, for participating in this program. So thank you, everyone. Take care. Bye now. Bye.